Mr. Goh, kindly settle down. The speakers, the distinguished moderator who is going to lead the conversation, both arrived. All the people who are enjoying the different, have it quickly so that you come and join us, not to miss the initial introduction part of it.
You are live on air, no?
Okay. Once again, good evening, ladies and gentlemen, all the viewers watching this program. This is the first time we are away from Zoom because a lot of people keep telling me there's a Zoom fatigue. Sometimes they get the MMF fatigue. We don't want any fatigue. That's why we came out of Zoom. I said we are going to be live today because the opportunity with a very, very limited people in the auditorium of 375 people, small number of 75 with all COVID protocols, we checked. And the idea is your safety is paramount important to us. At the same time, we wanted you to come and visit because as Soumya Swaminathan rightly put, is endemic is started, so we have to live with it. Better take precaution, start attending events, start doing your work as usual, and I think we have to live with what has happened. I got another 2 minutes to go, and I thought quickly tell you what's happening in MMA so that you don't miss any of them, which is by any chance you are missing your inbox. I know some of you really don't see because so many mails coming from MMA. That's the reason we want to tell you something interesting what's happening, you don't miss it. Now, what's happening on the 1st of September? We have also a number of events lined up, even in August, actually. Before I go to August, let me tell you, there's a nice event happening tomorrow. In fact, for the last 4 days, we have been having event. If somebody missed the event, what had happened yesterday, please do visit your YouTube, and it's a talk with Supriya Bhatnagar, outstanding, to tell you about all your inner, how you look after yourself, and how you really come out of some of the difficult situations of your own self-development. Very good. If you have, it's available on YouTube. And what is happening, that is tomorrow, 26th August. What you need to know about doing business in Dubai, and we got some outstanding businessmen from Dubai, and we have also from India, Mr. Ram Kumar will be leading the conversation with them. Then on Monday, the 30th of August, again, we have an event on Tamil Nadu CSR Summit, Forging Partnership and Impact Pathways. And this is, again, hybrid event. Let me tell you, hybrid event, we got some 15 outstanding speakers on the subject. And you can sit and come and attend, watch the program, but not all the speakers are joining. When we have a high profile event from all over India, they are joining online. So you can come interact with the co-colleague. We already have about 70 registration. We'll stop it at 100. And we have our Honorable Finance Minister, Palanivel Thyagarajan, Minister of Finance, has kindly agreed to launch a Tamil Nadu CSR Summit report. How the CSR is really fair in the state of Tamil Nadu, we'll be having. And we have got outstanding speaker lined up. It's a very big list. I don't want to go through that. Then on the 1st of September, again, we have a very, very interesting event, a discussion on the theme of the book, Harsh Realities, with the making of Marico. We have Harsh Mariwala. He's going to be coming and talking to us, again, online program. We have three outstanding corporate leaders who will be leading the conversation with Harsh Mariwala is Mr. Shankar. You all know Mr. Shankar is founder of CAMS, Kavita Chituri, joint managing director of KCP, and Mr. C.K. Ranganathan, managing director of Kevin Care. Then on the second, we have again an interesting event because so much news is Afghanistan. The theme of the discussion is going to be Afghanistan under Taliban, what it means for India and the world. We have got again outstanding panel, Indrani Bakshi, who is a diplomatic editor of Times of India. She'll be leading the conversation with Ambassador Rakesh Sood, retired IFS officer, Lieutenant General Atta Asani, you will see him regularly in the television, and also Captain Ashok Alok Bansal, is the director of India Foundation, specialist on Afghanistan. So you'll know all the thing, what's happening in Afghanistan. Then with this, I'm going to start the final event, not to be missed event, is on 3rd of September. Our MMA annual general body meeting is happening hybrid at MMA Auditorium, and we're also giving the award, and Ashmat Singhania is going to be the chief guest. Please do come, and this is the occasion where it's very emotional for us. We'll be sharing our achievement, what you have done over the period, sharing with you everything. It'll be very, very interesting for you. Then we have got a number of other events happening, and we'll share with you later. We almost even fixed up till October. It's been done. Now, coming to today's event, it's again a very, very special event for us because the person who was very part of MMA, who has been a great source of inspiration for us, MMA, we looked at the person who is going to be there today, not now, not yesterday, not to 4-5 years back itself, she came to MMA and spoke in one of our student women convention. Thereafter, we got continue to engage with her, and not only she's going to come, she's going to be coming along with her daughter to come and speak what happening, and the topic for this evening discussion is Champion Women, the Story of Global Adjustment. Ladies and gentlemen, put your hand together to welcome the distinguished speakers for this evening. Dr. Ranjini Manian, founder, chairperson of Global Adjustment, Rogini Manian, CEO Global, and to lead the conversation, we have our own Mr. Shankar, founder, CAMS, and director, ACSYS Investment Limited. May I request Mr. Shankar also come on the stage and take your place, sir. As I mentioned to you just a while ago, Dr. Ranjini Manian is not new to you. She is a part of our MMA Managing Committee. She successfully conducted a couple of events for MMA. One is the Women Managers Convention, where we really reached out to a large number of women, and she does some phenomenal work, very methodical. It's a pleasure to work with her. And Mr. Shankar is going to lead the conversation. He'll be really leading the conversation on the subject, which is a champion woman, the story of global adjustments. As usual, we don't have Zoom, otherwise you could have put your question in the chat box. Please send your question by WhatsApp, the number which is flashed on your screen, and the speaker, as well as it could be addressed to anybody, and they'll be delighted to respond to all your questions. Now, let me have the privilege of introducing Mr. Shankar. Mr. Shankar is founder CAMS and director ACSYS Investment Limited, and is a graduate of IIT Madras and IMC, and the founder of CAMS in 1988 to provide platform and services to the Indian mutual fund industry. He is involved with several organizations that provide entrepreneurship as well as both his alma mater. And Mr. Shankar is particularly, he's been a great source of support to MMA. He not only puts ideas, he's the one who put MMA in the map of CSR. Otherwise, MMA is always corporate social responsibility. We talk about it, but we never really implemented. Not only we implemented the CSR implemented the school children who are very poor school children, whose parents' income is less than 50,000 rupees. And we did some phenomenal work to reach out to the number of schools, especially some of the poor children's schools studying in both girls as well as boys' school, where we have reached to the children, it's really, really outstanding. We have done almost 350 programs with more than 3,000 students participated during the thing, and credit goes to Shankar for giving us the opportunity to do that. In addition to that, we also do some night tuition, number of other English teaching and all the thing for the children. Night tuition we're doing for the children across the where they live and across the apartments opposite, so that they also get really enlightened and join us. Now let me now request Shankar to take forward the conversation, which is going to be very inspiring this evening. As much as you, I'm also looking forward to hearing them. Over to you, Mr. Shankar.
Thank you, Group Captain. So as he said, MMA has been focusing on women entrepreneurs, women managers for quite some time now. We have a panel, and we've had many sessions that are of use to this community. And you know that we have had this series of events for the last few months, focusing on what I would like to call unique businesses. Businesses which are different from the mainstream because of one of their attributes. For example, printing a rocket. Who would have ever thought that you can print a rocket? But you know, I found it unique, and I thought it is a story worth telling. And as we search for more such entrepreneurs to highlight and talk about, we found that we have missed the greatest jewel of them all sitting right in our midst, which is Dr. Ranjini Manian and her group of firms. I will not just talk about global adjustments, because we will also be talking about her foundation later. But all that she is doing is such a unique confluence of the fact that she's a woman and she's an entrepreneur. So it actually fits both our bills extremely well, and I'm surprised that I myself did not notice it till quite late in the day. So it is a great honor for me to sit across the table from you.
Thank you, Shankar.
Please welcome.
Thank you, Shankar. Thank you, sir.
And it's a little belated because the event has been postponed, but I did want to congratulate you on your 40th wedding anniversary.
Oh, yes.
A little down the road, but still, congratulations.
Thank you, Shankar.
It is a milestone I hope to achieve one day in life. Now, in the last few years, the operating business, which is Global Adjustments, Ranjini has stepped back a bit from it, and her lovely daughter, Rohini, here, has taken over as the CEO of that business. And I am very pleased to welcome you to this forum, Rohini.
Thank you so much. It's my pleasure to be here.
So we will spend the next 30 minutes or so in conversation with the two of them. And then, as always, Group Captain Vijay Kumar will feed the questions to us, and we will take them in turn. So please keep the questions handy as they occur to you. Please WhatsApp them to the number given, and we will take them up. So Ranjini, I know you studied French at Elphinstone College in your early years, and then you went to Sorbonne, which is a distinction in itself, I think. Mm. We talk of the Ivy League universities in the US, but this is as much of an Ivy League university as any other. And after that, I find that you spent some time in Japan. So you hail from an ancient culture to begin with, and you have an affinity to the French language, French country, I assume, and Japanese culture. All these are really deep-rooted cultures, which have really not suffered any dislocations of the sort that you find, you know, in other cultures. And when I look at your, I know it's not your business anymore, it's us, but you know, it was originally your business. When I look at the term relocations over there, right? It seems to me that perhaps the insight that you had when you started that business was that relocating a family is quite different from relocating their possessions. And I thought that was a great USP at that point in time. And probably it continues to be, because certainly that business is going very strong. Tell us how this idea came into your mind. You know, it was not a time when you would think of those things, which is why it is unique. Idea is unique in its time, not in perpetuity. So it was a unique idea at the time. How did it come across to you, and how did you get the early? And I'm sure the execution must have been superb, because you know half of it is the execution. How did you go about this? Tell us about your early years, the struggles, the happinesses, the joy you get on the face of your clients, etc. Over.
That's great. So I have to tell you the story of 20 years in 3 minutes. Thank you, Shankar, for this opportunity. Thank you, everybody who's come here, despite our situation of. Everyone has had 2 vaccinations, so you're all safe here, and thank you for being here in person. The energy of a room with people is very special. We really miss it. So I'm so happy that you're here. And for those of you who are listening to us on Zoom and other platforms, thank you for tuning in. Because this is the story of, I think, passion, but also with effort. So I think, as you rightly pointed out, Shankar, being raised in Bombay, in a maybe professional white-collared family, where my mom rose to become the first woman to head up a nationalized bank. So knowing that women empowerment is about also contributing more than your family, and then saying, I don't just want to learn French literature in University of Bombay and have an accent which is not authentic. I want to go to Paris and study, so I become très français. So that dream being fulfilled by a father who always encouraged me to do what I had to fulfill my passion. So they sold off a small office space in Maker Bhavan in Nariman Point to be able to have the money to send me to Sorbonne University. And then landing in Sorbonne and thinking, what's the big deal? I speak French and I'm young and I have all my goals in front of me. I'll be fine. Then showing up there as a vegetarian, right? And then going to bed hungry every night, not knowing where to find the food, even though I had a little money in my pocket. So little things made so much impact that I would go to bed crying till I found the right people to befriend and who guided me and became part of my inner circle. And then the Sorbonne experience was fantastic. Fast forward a decade, and almost a decade, I'd had a little son and my daughter was not yet thought about, and I wanted to study a different language. So I took up Japanese here in Chennai at the Indo-Japan Center. And I realized once again that you have to be immersed in a culture to really understand it. So went off to Japan to live and work and become a cultural teacher and a language conversational teacher. And that again taught me so much. You know, which is the real Japanese? Is it that bowing, humble, polite person? Or is it that toughest steel person who can be very strict about whatever he or she has to achieve? So, you know, peeling the onion layers of culture became part of my life. And because of that, I think this idea was very close to my heart to try to relocate families from overseas to come to India. And the FDI had just opened then and foreign companies were coming in. The woman with whom I co-founded it, Shankar, was the wife of a US diplomat. That helped a lot, because Joanne Husky and I, being from two different cultures ourselves, the story of relocating foreigners into India was easy to think about. And then we had one of our early employees that we took on, who was a medical representative selling medicine in laboratories, who today is the president of Global Adjustments, Kalpana Murthy. I'm delighted you're here today. And so we built our team on women, because at that time there wasn't enough jobs being given to women. And I had decided this company is going to be all about only women. Big mistake. All women company, very difficult to handle. Ask Rohini, she'll tell you. It's now much more male. But those were the reasons that first struck me that I wanted to do an entrepreneurship. But the easy and the hard part of it, Shankar, if I can just say two things. The easy part was because Joanne understood processes. And I understood culture, but also the nuanced relationships of the cities that we were set up in. That partnership worked. So my lesson to entrepreneurs is, please always find a partner who complements your skills. Don't find two similar people doing the same thing. Then it may or may not work as fast as it can. So I think it was easy because of that combination. Challenge was always about people saying, it's a niche industry, new name, what is relocation? Why are you charging money for something which we have always done for free in India? Atithi Devo Bhava is our platform. We don't need to charge for this. You know, so breaking a new idea, all startups, it takes a little while, but absolutely hold on to your idea, because a time comes when the tipping point happens.
Thank you. That was a wonderful summary, 3 or 4 minutes of your really wonderful journey. I like that point about having complementary skills amongst the founders, and that is something that, you know, Rohini is a member of the Chennai Angels, and she looks for it as well. Also, I think being a sole founder is a bit of a lonely job sometimes, because you do go through stresses and aches, and there is nobody to unburden yourself, to share to bounce ideas off. So in more ways than one, as an entrepreneur, I think that having a team of 2 or 3 is actually a wonderful idea. Rohini, you stepped into big shoes, in a manner of speaking. But before that, you spent a little time in your reality business as well, right? Before you stepped into these shoes. And your education, in a sense, has also been in the softer disciplines, not in the harder disciplines of science and so on and so forth. Talk to us a little bit about how it is to step into such big shoes, to inherit relationships that were essentially your moms to begin with. And also, I'd like to know a little bit about how you relate to your, you know, brother and to your other business and so on. And whether the two businesses have anything to do with each other at all, do you interact and so on. So, go ahead.
First of all, thank you so much for having me here today. It's such a pleasure to be here. And it's so nice to, like my mother said, see a room full of people. It's refreshing. So a little bit about me. I actually first did join. I finished my schooling. I went to study business leadership. The only thing I've known my whole life is business. In our house, conversations at the dinner table were always about business and what's next and how do you get debt or equity and what is the real estate price here and how do you construct. So my first love is real estate. So it made complete sense for me to enter the real estate business. I first started by working with my brother in sales and marketing in Radiance Realty. And very soon I found out that I love my brother too much to work with him. And the next logical thing for me to do was to try and work with my mother. And thank you, Mom, you've given me such a fantastic platform. I love working at Global Adjustments. We are such a unique business. We interact with so many nationalities. We have offices pan-India, and every day I learn so much. And to be really honest, I have very little to do in Global Adjustments because of the fantastic team that I have of Kalpana and Anupama. We are still all women in the leadership. We've managed to retain that, but our man-to-woman ratio is now 50-50. When it comes to business, between the family, we do find a lot of synergy. We support each other. Varun and I are best friends. We are siblings, but we are best friends. We support each other. He is an ideas person. I'm the execution person. I'm very good at marketing and sales. He gets numbers really well. So we complement each other. And in all businesses that we do, we have a stake together in. So I recently founded a business called PropSierge, which is an end-to-end real estate platform which does construction, interiors, as well as brokerage and other services. And to answer in a short form, everything that I do is related to real estate, but I've taken the best learning from my mother, which is people first and culture first and warmth in everything you do, and that's a USP. And from my father, I've learned that process matters, number matters, discipline matters, and I think that's really taught me a lot. They are both my role models.
It's a privilege to be born in a family like this, Tony, I must tell
Absolutely.
You. If entrepreneurs could have the choice, they should choose where they're being born. Unfortunately, you don't have the choice. To either of you.
And women entrepreneurs shouldn't worry about, I can't look after my daughter, I can't go to sports day, I can't do her maths homework with her. See, they watch you and they can take over and then they set you free to go do your next thing. So actually, thank you, Rohini, for being there and being able to give me my freedom to go do the next thing. I just had to add that.
Absolutely. See, when we, you deal a lot with expats in the course of your business, and one of the all-time curiosities of human beings is, how do others look at us? How do others perceive us? What do they think of us? And you know, in the early days when I used to travel abroad, oh, you speak English. That used to be the first reaction. And then people came here. I remember one of the first visitors that I was escorting from the airport back. They were so excited to see a cow on the road. Oh, that's actually true. You can actually see cows on the road. So those were the perceptions of India at that point in time, and I'm sure things are quite different these days. I just want you to dig back into your memory banks and tell us some quirky, memorable, teachable incident that you might have had with any of your projects in the past.
Sure. So about 2 years, 2.5 years ago, I was 7 months pregnant. And I got a call from my office saying, it's a very senior CEO, a $1 billion company CEO, is coming to town on his private jet, and you have to meet him. So of course I went to meet him at the Leela lobby. He had an armored car, 4 bodyguards, and he wanted to explore Chennai because they're planning to set up here. Took him to see a couple properties. Within 4 minutes, he bought 2 $4 million apartments, not kidding. And paid it on his credit card.
Wow.
And after that, we went to have lunch at the Madras Club. And I learned so much from him that day. You know, we have such a different expectation of people at the top and of expats. But I couldn't finish what I ate. And he asked me, aren't you going to pack this? Why would you want to waste food? That's the first thing I learned from somebody so senior. The second thing is, he wanted to register his property immediately because he had paid it in full. And when we went to the registration office, it took, you know, bureaucracy at that point in time took a little bit of time. So it took about 2, 2.5 hours. The developer, the person who, the MD of the development company, and I were getting super impatient, checking our watch, asking that man, konja seekrama panna, seekrama panna. And he's sitting back, relaxing, and he's saying, it's okay, everything takes time, I'm patient. And that really taught me something, that what they perceive of us is so different, but what we think of people in such senior positions as well is so different. That was huge learning for me.
Very interesting, very interesting.
I had a, well, stressful experience that then later, now in the retailing, it's funny, because they were coming and checking our building, saying some super VIP is going to come, we have to check security protocol, whether you're building in your office is okay. We have a office dedicated to Indian culture, Shankar. You have to come and visit us. Everyone at MMA is welcome as soon as COVID lets you come. And we were building it with the doors and windows of India, and we had made a cultural building, which is small but dedicated to the nation. And there were all these bodyguards again. They were checking everything, and they wouldn't tell us who it was. It was Amazon that had hired us, and so we were working with them. But from the way the bodyguards were coming, I knew this is going to be the head of Amazon is?
Jeff Bezos.
I knew it was going to be Jeff Bezos. So we guessed. They wouldn't tell us because it was a secret. The government didn't know he was coming. The industries didn't know he was coming. So the press should not know that he was coming, etc. So, of course, Jeff Bezos walks in, and they're telling me, do the whole Indian culture thing in 1 hour. He's a man of very little attention. He can't do much time with you. So I was, of course, ready. But when he walked in, he was super stressed. He'd lost his BlackBerry.
Oh.
Jeff Bezos' BlackBerry has all the contacts of his life in it, right? And where was it lost? In the second following car that was whatever, piloting him or whatever. And so for the first few minutes, he was very distracted and didn't want to do anything. And I just took him to the altar just to distract him, okay? And I showed him a Ganesha, Saraswati and a Lakshmi that were there. And I said, look at this, this is India. And he's like, okay, so is he married to both those women? I'm like, no, she looks after the wealth. She looks after the wisdom. He balances those two and that's why he can remove obstacles. And then he liked that so much. And I said, they're not related, but the concepts are related in India. Anything you come to do here, understand the concepts, you will always do well. That's it. He forgot about his BlackBerry. He said, come on, let's do the program. So I think when you interpret our culture, it works well. And then in the next 15 minutes, they brought the BlackBerry too, by the way. So we heard the loud Jeff Bezos honking laughter that he's famous for. And he asked a lot of questions on retail, Rohini. And I couldn't do retail with all the bodyguards and him sitting in the room. Amit Agarwal, who is now the current head of Amazon, was also with him. And questions on retail, how can you answer sitting inside a room in an auditorium, right? So I said to him, you've got to come to Nalli Sari shopping with me and that's how you're going to learn this. And right enough, he agreed. So he pulled off his bodyguards the next morning and he came with us to the sari shop. And it was fun because when I walked in with him, there was one mami who recognized me and said, and I'm like, I don't know. And then showing him how people buy saris, right? How groups decide which sari the bride should buy, how we are price sensitive. Kumaran, like the 500 rupees cheaper, let's go over to Kumaran. So he was actually able to watch our retail behavior and through this event. And it just taught me that if you ask nicely, if you speak confidently about your subject matter expertise, then as a startup, as an entrepreneur anywhere, you gain the respect of no matter who it is. And that was the big story that always I love to tell, because many years later, my sister who was at the Stanford alumni met Jeff in San Francisco. And she said, my sister trained you in Indian business culture. And she said, and he said, oh, she should become a stand-up comedian. She's very good. So he thought I was funny, but just a story.
Very interesting.
And that's so why now Rohini does warehousing for Amazon. You have to ask her that.
How
you take that relationship forward.
Oh, nice. That must be a pretty massive warehouse, I can imagine. The way Amazon has exploded in the last year or two. No, you're right, and I agree with you that one of the great qualities of senior foreign professionals is that they know when they don't know something, and they're perfectly happy to listen to somebody who knows, regardless of their level, to learn. That is a quality which I wish some of our Indian leaders would have, which sometimes you find a little missing. So, very interesting point. Rohini, how have you seen this whole COVID-19 play out in your business? Just want to understand.
So COVID-19 has actually completely hit our industry, the relocation industry, because we are so dependent on FDI coming here and setting up. And foreigners have completely stopped coming to India from last March till about now. It's been extremely slow, 80% less. We have only 20% of the normal volume. But fortunately for us, because we diversified and expanded a couple years ago, what we are noticing is that the Indian clientele is way more involved and way more aggressive when it comes to real estate practices. So we are managing okay. And that being said, the way that our current government in Tamil Nadu is handling COVID-19 has been fantastic. The kind of movement we are seeing come in right now with FDI has been really, really good. It's positive, and I think things are going to get a lot better.
Wonderful.
I'd like to take a minute to share a small story with you about what happened 2 weeks ago. So on May 24th, we got the new government in. And for me and my business, the industries minister is extremely important. I sent him a message. I got his number and sent him a message introducing myself. Good morning, sir. I'm Rohini Manian. I run this company that helps with FDI. Please, may I meet you? I'm not kidding you. Within 45 minutes, I get a reply. Good morning, madam. Can we meet day after at 9:30 a.m. in my office? So I replied saying, thank you, sir. Then again, I didn't know where his office was. I sent him a message. Where is it, sir? He tells me the address. I show up 9:25, comes in at 9:35, and he tells me, sorry, madam, I'm 5 minutes late for this meeting. I got stuck at the secretariat. Wow. So this is the change we are seeing today in Tamil Nadu as a state. And this is the way that FDI is going to come in. So honestly, I think we are in a golden decade and we should make the most of it.
So heartening to hear that.
Fantastic, sir.
If I do not know the expat business that well, but my impression is that there was a lot of social stuff surrounding it, which all requires in-person attendance and so on. So before that, a question. Did you actually see an outflow of people, or was it just that the inflow had stopped?
Complete outflow. So most of the people repatriated. They cut their leases short. Anupama, Kalpana and team had a very tough time because they wanted to cut their leases short. Companies went into complete cost-saving mode. Rentals that were at 2 lakhs, companies wanted to slash it to 1. Families left. Now, there were split relocations where the working partner was here but the family was back home.
Right.
It was complete chaos. And what was really bothering people at that time was that this complete lockdown gave them very limited access to basic things for them, which are things like groceries. The biggest problem that expats had was lack of groceries. And they can't drive, right? And you weren't allowed drivers coming in or Uber or any of that. So that was actually one of the main reasons that expats left.
Okay, got it. And I was coming to that question, which is that there was a lot of social activity surrounding this business. I remember I subscribed to Culturama, so I keep seeing those. Now, did you manage to substitute any of those with the Zoom events and so on, or it was just a wash?
Yes, we did. We did do a couple of Zoom events. But what we noticed is that people were getting Zoom fatigue.
Yeah, you're right.
And instead, what we did is we put a WhatsApp support group for every city that we have our offices and our clientele in. We had an expat WhatsApp support group where they had 24/7 access to a global adjustments representative along with a senior person's number to speak through anything they had. And they used our helpline a lot for support and meeting other like-minded people. And now we are back to hosting safe like this coffee mornings and lunches for our clients.
Excellent. And so I wanted to talk to you about Champion Woman and what you are doing since you moved out of day-to-day at Global Adjustment. So can you just introduce the initiative and then we can take it forward?
Sure. So when Rohini gave me the opportunity to take over the wonderful team and the really rich clientele of over 400 multinational corporations that we look after across India in 7 locations, it allowed me the chance to do which is what I have always wanted to do, which was get more women to be in the workforce, to be working in any area of interest. It could be an NGO, it could be in the corporate world, it could be as an entrepreneur. And I love to encourage women to become entrepreneurs because you can carry your business along with you through every stage of your journey. And so I got a chance, therefore, to start something called Champion Woman, which is spearheaded by a separate spin-off company called Global Adjustments Foundation. Whatever we have earned at Global Adjustments that I have been able to set aside is a self-funded foundation. And we used to run concerts every year called IKEA, bringing musical geniuses together in a new format. And those donor passes and support we got helped us with this work. The work is the following. It is called a life leadership workshop. We have several subjects that we teach which are not being taught in college or the workplace or at home. For example, how do I build my self-esteem? Is this even discussed anywhere? You know, that kind of a topic. And can it be taught in a classroom? You'll be surprised. It actually can. Women are very quick to learn from one another. You tell a woman, she'll go 4 hours. You know that story, right? You tell a man, nod and probably be happy or sad. Yeah. But the woman, she'll go tell 4 others. So because of the woman always wanting to tell 4 others, this movement grew quite easily, Shankar. And I found that the whole curriculum was built around those areas that I found the MNCs thought were lacking in women in India. And that is, every milestone in their personal life, they would just quit work immediately. Yes, there was a big family that was very important to the woman, but did they support her? Did she have the confidence to speak up and ask for that support? All of that was missing. So at the entry level, companies like Dow Chemicals or Ford Motor Company or Hyundai, anybody would have a lot of women intake, but very soon they would just drop off. And so it became very clear that these MNCs or even our Indian corporates want to have as many women as men in their workforce, but women have to self-power from within and say, hey, I'm going to do this. I'm going to do this along with my family. And because of the Indian ethos, which you said, I was raised with an Indian ethos, it is taking your family along with your success. It's not the liberation feminist woman movement at all. Champion woman is made up of those things that I studied at the Harvard Women's Business Leadership Board. And I brought those concepts of gender intelligence here, but adapted them to the Indian scenario. And that's what it is. We've worked with 175,000 women now. And our executive director, Lakshmi, here is my biggest support in it. She does great work. We are partnering with MMA. Thank you, sir, group captain, for always encouraging us to do work with colleges. Group captain Venkataraman also helps us. We do work in corporates and colleges. Free workshops. I say free and everybody thinks it's not valuable. I really don't know what to do. I charged a lot, everybody was ready to pay. Now I'm saying free, nobody wants to take it. But when they take the first introductory program, then they call us back for more and more. So the program is working very well. We've got a white paper we've created to show the impact that these programs are having on women. It's made up of work-life integration. It's made up of optimism and resilience topics. How do you actually become resilient in the world? And I think women are really living out their potential after they go through our programs.
Wonderful. You referred to women working, joining MNCs and leaving after some time, so on. But you also talked about 175,000. So obviously the number includes other women as well, working in other places, perhaps IT companies, etc., etc. What is your catchment? Who are the women who normally benefit from your sessions?
In the beginning, beggars couldn't be choosers, Shankar. So I used to take any group of women that would have us and do our program. So we even did it. In fact, I'd like to take a moment to give a tribute to the Afghan women who are going through so much difficulty. Yeah. We had 30 Afghan soldiers here who did our program. They'd come to the Officers Training Academy,
yeah,
and they invited us to do a program for them. I had to do it in Pashto. I don't know Pashto. A combination of Japanese and French became Pashto for me that day. But what I did is I did it in Hindi, and they came here to be trained to do the AK-47 shooting. So we did something called AK-47 for your mind. Mm. And they loved it because I did it in Hindi, and somebody, one of the army soldiers translated it into Pashto. A was Aadmi Aurat Intelligence, you know, man, woman, gender intelligence. And the K we said was for key to happiness has to be your emotions. So we said you have to do this with four techniques and you have to do it 7 days a week. They loved it. They danced. They're banned from dancing in their own country. They danced with us. They meditated with us. And it was just such a moving experience. And now every day in my prayers, I remember those 30 Afghan army girls that we met, soldiers. And I hope that they're well somewhere. But I'm just saying, we used to take anything, any kind of working women, and we would run the programs for them. Now, it's very much in the workforce, whether it is IT or corporate or MNC or health warriors. Lakshmi did a program the other day for 9,000 nurses. So it can be any working woman who wants to have her home life and her work life integrated.
And what are the top two or three issues that recur in this population, which I think, which in your opinion need perhaps longer time or structural change to get addressed holistically?
So Rohini is a very good example of a young woman who has to look after parenting,
yep,
and has all the expectations from a mother who is very different from her. You can see how we are dressed. We're even different in the way we are dressed. So, you know, always giving advice. Poor Rohini has to ask me, now, are you saying this as the founder of some company or are you saying it as my mother? But it's just, she has to balance a lot. She has to have Indian roots and fly on global wings. So I think that generation of 30s to 40s, those women are the most important women we want to help. Because what is coming as a recurring thing is, how are you going to keep your relationships real? In a world of artificial intelligence and machine learning, how are you going to use real intelligence and human learning? And that's what this program addresses. It takes time, Shankar, as you said. And that's why we're doing a digital app to be able to continue to be in touch with our participants.
So wonderful to hear. I I mean, words escape me. You see the exact opposite of all this happening in a part of the world, which is disempowering women and so on. It's such a sad situation. I want to take a segue into the economic growth of India, and you started the topic off. I was going to lead to it at some point. The role that it may be Atmanirbhar, but still we need capital from abroad at the very least, because we certainly don't have capital. So we need ideally companies to come up and set up factories here, use our people, use our resources to manufacture stuff which hopefully they can take back to their home countries and find a market for. That is the ideal scenario for us. To me, that means Atmanirbhar. How are we doing as a state and as a country? And what are the top things you're hearing from MNCs? The things that bother them, the things that, also the things that they find good about India. Why just the things that bother them? Things that they find good about India and in this whole India-China situation. Where do we really stand? We imagine things and, you know, but where do we really stand? What are the obstacles in our way? What are the good things that we should talk about and leverage more? Some thoughts.
Thank you. This is such an important question, and in our industry, we discuss this so much. A couple of things that we definitely have scope to improve. I actually am on a panel with the guidance and the industries to talk about this regularly, is our social infrastructure. When I mean social infrastructure, as a state, let's talk about Tamil Nadu right now. We don't have enough access for recreation or social activities for expats. And that is a very important part of their life. They thrive on it. They work hard, they party hard. So that is something that we need to definitely improve. The second thing is schooling. Our access to international standard schools is very limited, and the one that we do have is well out of budget for most people. So that is a gap right now in Tamil Nadu, and if this is fixed, we can attract a lot more talent for sure. That being said, what we are doing well is how fantastic the current government is. They are completely transparent, they are approachable, accessible, and I'm hearing from every MD, I work with most of them, at least 80% of the companies in the state, all of them are saying, today the government is calling me and asking me, how can we help you? How can we value add? So I think we're in a wicket where we are here to win. The second thing we are doing very well is that the Modi government is also very pro-FDI, and there are a lot of benefits that are coming in for FDI that's entering the country. So across the country, we are seeing good FDI come in.
So you made a very good point on social. At a previous meeting, there was a CIC session with the chief minister and so on and so forth, where Venu had referred to this point. He said social infrastructure, nobody I think understood what social infrastructure meant at that point in time. But it is true, all that you said is very true. If I hear a crib from any of my friends abroad who do not become members of, you know, one of the clubs, it is that they feel left out, basically. So yeah, social infrastructure is very important, and that too when factories are a little apart from Chennai, it becomes even more of a disaster. What do you do to cool off?
Me?
Yeah.
I'm very interested in fitness. So my way to blow off steam is to either run or do some kickboxing or cycling. And I have a very good set of friends who I like to go out with on the weekend. So I'm also the work hard, party hard, exercise hard kind of person.
Wonderful.
And my daughter. Great.
You have a young daughter, don't you?
She's 2.5.
Yeah. Such a wonderful age. Anjini, a word of advice from you. You've been giving words of advice all along, but formally, a word of advice from you for women professionals. Not a word, it can be many words also.
No. Women professionals, it's very simple. Use the power of and, that's all. Should I be married or should I study? Should I be working? Should I take a transfer or should I remain with my husband? Should I look after my daughter or should I apply for that promotion? Remove this word or from your vocabulary. Use the power of the word of and. And when we use the and you look for solutions, they appear, provided you know how to seek support. So we have to articulate the support we need, both at home and at work. But if we do that and we believe in ourselves that I can actually do it all, then we can select the right things we want to do, maybe drop off the time guzzlers, right? Women who are in the workforce, we have to be selective about the quality of time we give to our children and to our families, yeah, and about the quantity of things that we get involved in. And so instead of juggling all the balls, is there one ball that you can throw so someone else can catch? Just give it to someone else, outsource that. I couldn't cook when these children were growing up. I outsourced, I threw the ball to my cook. Till today, he's the king of the house. So do that, throw the ball to someone else who will catch it for you. And then when you need to take that back, it will be available and you can do it. But don't try to do it all. Do a few things really well and add value to this world.
I think that's wonderful advice. I think you're right. Too many people feel inadequate if they don't do all the things that they're supposed to do. And they don't have to feel inadequate at all. I think, as you said, some of those tasks are eminently outsourceable to somebody else, and you look after your whatever you think is your core thing to do. So, yeah. So, are we ready to take questions yet? So, thank you. We will. It's not yet the end. We have, I'm sure, a number of questions too.
Sorry.
So, that's okay, take your time. So Rohini, you've been investing away, I understand. I want to bring your investing career into the public light a little bit. So.
Yeah, I'm very interested in the startup space. And I'm part of, we have some of our TCA members here, Mr. Mali and Mr. Ramki.
What are the investments that you made and why did they catch your fancy, those particular ones?
Sure, so one of them is a product, I've just made the investment today. Called Bumberry. It's a reusable diaper product, and as a new mother, I know how important that is, and I see a lot of scope for growth. I look at businesses that are scalable and have the tech angle to them, because I think that can do. And more than the idea, I look at the founder and his execution capability. Even a half-baked idea, if there is a strong execution and a founder I believe in, I invest in that.
Very sound view.
To you and ask for investment many years ago, Shankar?
Why didn't you? Because I might not have been able to invest at that point.
I didn't think about asking for investment at all.
Yeah, you said when you started that you came from a sort of white-collar professional family. Me too. It was only as you move along that you gain the capability to do things. You know. So, yeah.
Thank you, Mr. Shankar. Thank you, Mr. Anjanmani and Rohini. It's again a fascinating re-ever success story because I know quite a bit I heard before. The number of questions come over, 740 people are watching this program live from various social media portals. The number of questions come, we'll try and accommodate as many as possible. We got some time today. The first question is addressed to Rohini. It's from Nidhi. I'm working in a company as a senior executive. I have a question on leadership. You have taken over an organization which already had many senior people. As a young leader, what did you do to gain their confidence and were there any challenges? And also another related question from another person from Varadarajan in Chennai. She says, you succeeded your mother in the business, who is very popular, very smart, very efficient, and very difficult to succeed an efficient person and continue to emulate her and live up to the other's expectation. How do you manage this situation?
So that's a challenge I completely faced when I started out. I'm going to address the second question first. Stepping into big shoes is never easy. So what I did is, I can never be my mother. That's something I can never be. She's an amazing person, and I'm not saying this because I'm her daughter. I think there's so much we can learn from her. So I didn't try to be her. I tried to be authentic to myself and try to emulate and take the best practices that she would. I think that is something that I did. The second thing is that I'm definitely younger than most of the people that I do have as senior leadership in my team. But what I had to do in the beginning is work twice as hard and twice as long to know more. If you know more and you can value add to people, you earn their respect. You can't command respect, you need to earn it. And I learned that very early.
Lovely, madam. Another question is the daughter of Dr. Anjali Mani a boon or is difficult? Because you gain so many, at the same time you get a lot of comparison and a lot of expectations. How did you manage to balance the expectations without how to live up to your father, your mother's brand value which they have built over a period?
I think I was brought up to be very confident. So I've never felt, it never bothered me. I just feel proud when somebody says your parents have done so well or your brother's doing so well. I just feel proud and I feel happy. And my parents have always taught me to stand on my own two feet. We've always had a budget as children. I've learned the value of money from my father. I've learned how to be confident from my mother. So nothing really makes me uncomfortable or nervous like that. I respect people, but I'm not afraid of anyone.
Another interesting question from Mr. Ravi from Madurai. He says, I also inherited business like you, but from my father. But my father, though, handed over the business to me and said, you do it. But every 1 hour, he'll call me, don't do that, don't do that, and he'll always interfere. So how do you manage such a situation? Can you give me some tips how to handle my father?
Yeah, sure. So it's a really, really fun and interesting question. I'm going to be candid here. So after I took over from my mother, for the first 6 months, we'd have long discussions, conversations, sort of borderline arguments. And then I asked her the question which she brought up. Are you talking here as my mother or my founder? And I'm happy to listen to advice from my founder, but not from my mother. And this is said with respect and love, but there can only be one captain to guide a ship. And when you need that advice, you need to go and ask, but you need to do it with humility and respect. You can't be arrogant, and you need to be very grateful for what they've given you. Makes a big difference when you do it with humility.
So I'd like to advise the father, walk away. Walk away, go do your next thing, find your next passion. In fact, you should have that passion already, because I've achieved so much in our little team. You know, it was difficult to leave as a founder, CEO, with full paraphernalia to go and plug your own mic and everywhere talk. I don't even know how to do all that stuff, right, when I started. But it's good, it's a new challenge, and you'll become very successful in that third act. And they say, no, that the acorn cannot grow under an oak tree. The oak has to move away. The acorn has to have its own sunshine and its own values and its own inner strength to come out. And I think that's why Rohini and her team are blooming now, because I stopped even looking at P&L in year one, and I've not attended any of their meetings. I'm available for any massive advice, but they're fine. They don't need you. So can you tell Ravi of Madurai to tell his father to talk to me?
Good, we'll tell. Okay. Not only that, madam, as we have a founder like you who keeps such a good reserve, we don't have to worry about the P&L, I suppose. Yes, here's a question from Mr. Shankar. The says, sir, the failure rates, this again from Mr. Gurunathan from Chennai, the failure rates of startups is as high as 70%. What do you think are some of the main reasons for the high failure rates, and what role can leadership play, not just in prolonging the life of the startups, but also in ensuring that they emerge as a successful enterprises?
So actually, Rohini alluded to this, and I reinforced that point. I think most startups, if they fail because their skill set is not well-rounded. Their leadership skill set is not well-rounded. So you see, for example, tech-oriented entrepreneur knows a lot about his product and the technology, but does not know much about marketing and even fundraising for that matter, which is very important in that stage of life. So I would say the number one reason is that you're not well-rounded, and therefore you do not make a proper business plan, you do not present your case appropriately to investors who might be interested, and there'll always be an investor interested. You just have to present your case in a hard-hitting manner, and of course you have to find that guy. So these are, I think, the main issues. I think getting a right, even if you don't have a partner, if you don't choose to have a partner, which is not the best thing, but okay, let's say that is your choice, at least go and find a good mentor. Go and find a couple of good mentors who can help you and whom you're willing to be helped by. It's also another thing to be want to be helped by mentors. To notionally say, I have a mentor, but I'm not going to listen to him also doesn't make sense. So I think to get all the functions, all the skills required to start up, which is a lot. A large company has departments and departments to handle all those things. As a founder, you've got to do all those things yourselves. So you need to have all those skills or acquire them through founders or through mentors or some way or the other. Otherwise, it's bound to be a failure at some point in time. That's what I would say.
Excellent, sir. You would like to add on, Rohini, anything on this, on the startups?
For me, I think it's execution. As a startup, you have an idea, you are trying to solve a problem, or you're trying to innovate in something, but it's all about execution after that. So arrive at a business plan that's logical, and as Shankar sir said, try to get advice from people around you, or try to get inputs. You need an auditor. Finance is very important. A lot of startups I work with have no idea what a P&L is. They want fundraising, but they put crazy valuations that make no sense. So arrive at a business plan and try like hell to stick to it.
Yeah, true. You are part of an angel investor. So you get after the person whom invested, you keep tracking him, what's happening, how to do that in the form of interventions and guidance.
We're always there to help and door open, but Chennai Angels has such strong leadership, I can't really value add there. But in other investments that I do offline, I work very closely with the founders and try to see how we can value add.
Thank you. Madam, it's a very interesting question to Dr. Ranjini Manian. It's come from Mr. Soundararajan from Bangalore. It's all about relocation. He says, Madam, people settle down in India, they're so happy, and by the time they want to go back, they so much enjoy the country, they don't like to go back. Do you give some any relocation back to their country for of origin for them to settle down? Is there any time happened such a situation where the guys really, you know, found it difficult to relocate themselves back to the country of origin?
Find it difficult to leave India. They come into India crying and they leave India crying because they miss India so much when they leave. And going back to their own country, I think I've said this story to you before, that John Flannery, the head of GE, wrote me the first email after going 1 week back into the head of GE in America and said, it's so boring and predictable, there is not even a mosquito in my cabin here, what am I going to do? So, you know, they miss India. But relocating people back to other countries has been an idea that Kalpana, Anupama and the whole team here has mooted. And I think you've done some small bits of it in neighboring countries, but not full-fledged because the focus moved to a different real estate side of business. But they're doing a lot of intra-India moves. They do a lot of relocation within India, right? Of Indians moving from state to state. Yes. Do you want to just add that maybe?
Yeah, so a lot of the moves we see within the country, talent from the north will come and work in the south. That kind of relocation also, once people live in Chennai, yes, they don't want to go back to Delhi or they don't want to go back to Haryana. True. So we do see things like that a lot.
Thank you. I got a couple of more questions. I would like to give an opportunity to the audience here. Yes, so you have to be very brief and short so that yes, the mic is coming to you, sir.
And all
you can
the
introduce
students,
yourself and ask the questions.
You can please ask a question, students also after that.
Yes, please.
Before entering the hall, I did not know anything about global adjustment. I was talking to my friend. He threw some light on.
Keep your mic closer to your thing, sir.
Yes. Global adjustment.
Yes, thank you.
But I found what I learned from him about global adjustment is that, you know, a man of virtues, man or woman of virtues, will definitely succeed in global adjustment. So that's what I understood. Okay. So what type of training are not simply giving lectures or on talking on morals or nothing like that, but anyways, virtues are to be inbuilt into the personality. So in your business, any segment is there for imbibing the virtues in their personality? I just want to know.
Yeah, the very basis, thank you for that question. It's a very important topic to talk about values and virtues. The very core of our curriculum when we train champion women, nowadays with the pandemic, we're not only training women, Shankar. In the 43,000 people that we trained this year, all with webinars, 17,000 are men within the companies like Infosys and Cognizant and so on, because men and women are both needing these programs that we run. And it is based on the important pillar of mental wellness. And that's become such an important virtue to work at. Earlier, we were postponing it to tomorrow. I'll do it, ma'am, when I also have to color my hair like you. That time I'll start meditating. Seriously, now you need to do it now. So the virtue is, can you look after your mind so that you have a healthy mind and a healthy body and contribute to the world? So the most important one that we're doing now is emotional well-being. And that has become maybe empathetic leadership. That's the virtue that will come out of it, because people will become empathetic and that will build any business, any startup or any business that people are in. Thank you.
Great. So I'll come back to audience. Meanwhile, you can think and note your question so that next will be your audience question. Meanwhile, here's a question from Mr. Philip from Hyderabad to Dr. Ranjini Manian. He says, Madam, culture eats strategy for breakfast. You know the famous statement. Now, what about cross-cultural issues is in the organization? Is it lunch or dinner? What's your experience, Madam?
Cross-cultural experience is simply the two softwares have to talk to each other. That's all. If you try to eat chapati with I don't know, with more Korumba. It's got its own little combination, but it's not the perfect combination, right? So it's like a thali, an Indian thali, where everything is got to be eaten in a certain format, and you don't mix the payasam with the rasam. Do you ever do that? Yeah, so cross-culture has got to be part of every meal by understanding the value of that culture and then putting, and then understanding where you come from, so you meet in the middle.
Great. Yes, again a question to you, madam. It's come from a professor from City College, Dr. Saraswati. She won't know, these days the attention span of students is very less. Since you also work with a large number of students, what technique does your team use to train them? Because we know that your college programs are very popular and people talk quite a lot about it. How do you really ensure the attention span of the students are really enhanced, whether it's online or offline classes?
Well, I was speaking to someone who's a faculty here from SIET College. Lovely to meet you, ma'am. We've done a lot of work in various colleges. The important thing is to keep three things. The teacher herself should have some humor. At least once I should make you all laugh. Otherwise, how are you going to keep attention? And second, there should be some practical takeaway. When you walk out the door, there should be one thing I want to start doing or stop doing. That's how you help or hold the attention span of students as well. And there should be interactivity. These are the three things that I recommend for students and in the new way of learning as well. Great. Add to that, Rohini?
No, I completely agree, and I don't think it's students only. I think it's with anybody. Attention span is getting shorter and shorter with everybody. So keep points precise, concise, and don't try and explain too long to other people, especially with PowerPoints. It's called death by PowerPoint.
Shastri, you're adding to that?
Yeah, you said it all.
Thank you. Here is a question again to Rohini. This is again from Geeta in Chennai. He says, Rohini, I am a girl student from Madurai. I am hesitant to become an entrepreneur because my parents want me to get married in a few years. I am scared because it may be difficult to manage family and business. Can you give me some tips how to manage such a situation in life while beginning a woman entrepreneur? Because I am very keen to do the business because my mind is not in the marriage.
I love this question and I wish more people would talk about it. It should never be marriage, love or your career. I think for a woman and for me especially, what's made me so strong is having a very strong career and being financially independent. You don't need to be dependent on anybody, a parent, a spouse, a partner, anybody. Stand up on your own two feet. And it's completely possible to do both. I went back into the workforce when my daughter was 9 days old. I stopped working a day before she was born. So there's no need to do either or. And have those open conversations with your parents. Parents think the best for you. They want you to be happy. So tell them how you feel, and you'll be surprised that when you stand up for yourself, people will respect you so much more and you'll gain so much more. You'll get your way in the end. But do it with respect and do it calmly. Don't go and fight. It never works well.
True. Is a question again from Radhika to Dr. Anjali Manian. He said, the Global Adjustment Foundation touched over 1,75,000 think people, as you mentioned, in the Champion Women program, and where you focused on leadership amongst women, further where they manage themselves. But today, what is lacking in women is a skill development. Have you done any initiative to improve the skilling of the women so that they become more employable and more wanted in organizations which you would like to employ them?
Skill development is extremely important, and there are many NGOs that are doing it. So no, we are not in that space, but we are partnering with several NGOs, or not even for-profit businesses, that are skilling people. And we're adding this layer of life leadership so that they can bloom wherever they are planted. That's how we're working. And now the newest word that Modi ji has brought about is sashaktikaran for the woman. That means self-powering the woman. And that's important. Nobody can give you the power. You have to take the power and power yourself to go forward with financial independence, with good relationships in your family, with your goal setting, and with your self-esteem to move forward. Anybody here in the audience is asking us a question?
Yes, anybody?
Some
any
student
questions?
There?
Students? Anybody? Anybody? Come, give the mic there.
So my question is to Rohini ma'am. So as being a, I've been a student of an MBA student. So in a young age, you have been taking a huge CEO. How we balance this? We, as a child, we used to be kick with the friends and enjoy with parents. How we balance this, both the things, being a huge CEO of a company and chatting the friends, life balance is my first question. And second one is, in if you not been a kind of CEO or kind of a industrial anything, what will be your being in childhood? We will be using, we will want to be a doctor. What you will be a, if not be a CEO of industry, or what will be a next option for it?
All right, thank you for that. So work-life balance is very, very important. So for me, my order of priority is my family and work family are the same for me. So work and family first any day. But I make it a point to stay in touch with, I have a handful of very close friends, and I make it a point to see them once a week. Every Saturday night, I try to see my friends. So that's how I get the work-life balance in, and it helps me blow off a lot of steam and be balanced. If I wasn't an entrepreneur or I wasn't in business, I think I'd like to be a lawyer. I think I can argue, out-argue anybody.
That I can tell you.
Anybody else? Yes, go ahead, sir. Is the mic, please, sir. We'll take
good question.
Two.
Young yes. Man, that was a very good question.
Namaskaram. I am Ramesh. Well, this is a question to Ranjini. You haven't mentioned about your great publication that you have been bringing out at a glance once upon a time, and now it is Culturama, and book that would give him a lot of depth into the kind of knowledge about the enterprise that you are heading, number one. And what has been your learning from your guru, Paramarthananda?
Thank you, Ramesh. Shankar mentioned Culturama, that he had been reading it, and he alluded to it. So we, neither Rohini nor I brought it up. It's been a pride of our company. It's been the only marketing we've ever done. I don't think we've had an advertising budget in Global Adjustments because Culturama does it for us. We've done a free publication of a magazine, and students, it's online now on culturama.in. You can read. It's got good stories about India, about the world, and about bringing the best of both together. So yes, that was a passion, and that we're very happy. Rohini is now the editor-in-chief and has brought a very nice angle, updating it to modern trends as well. And what have I learned from my teacher, my guru? There's only one value that he says we have to live by, and I keep reminding myself of that, and that is, do to others what you want done to you. That's all. Everything else fits in it, right? You want them to be honest, you be honest. You want them to pay attention to you, pay attention to them, whatever it is. So I think there's that beautiful, beautiful way of giving it in a nutshell. And thank you for reminding me of that.
Thank you, madam. I think we'll try and squeeze in two last questions before we come to the end of the session. Here is a question to Rohini. What is the biggest challenge you faced? This is a question from Mr. Mohan Ratnam from Chennai YouTube. What is the biggest challenge you faced in your endeavor as an entrepreneur? And how did you overcome? And what did you learn from it? And he's also added another question. Your family support was fantastic from the what we had. How much is your husband's support in your endeavor?
I'll take the second question first. My husband has been a great source of support for me. And if I didn't have his support, I don't think that I could have gotten anywhere in my career where I have today. I would have either been successful all my career and not had a happy family life, or I would have been a homemaker. And my child is actually unwell today. She's been unwell since yesterday. And my husband said, no, you have a commitment. I was at work all day. I'm here today, and he's helping with the child. So that's a great, something that I really need to acknowledge. Not many people do that. My father did it for my mother and my husband for me. And I need you to please help me with the
second,
the question
other one
again.
Is risk-taking abilities. And what is
the challenge? The challenge that I faced. One of the largest challenges that I did face was, like many of us, overcoming COVID. When this industry was so badly hit, it was very difficult to know what was the right step to do. What should I do? And should I furlough people, or should I try and change the way things were done? How long is it going to take? We still don't know. Business still hasn't improved in other cities. But what we did is I trusted my gut, and my gut told me that you have a very loyal team. You have a team that's been with you for a very long time. Take care of them and they'll take care of your customers. And that's exactly what I did. I trusted my gut. My P&L, I showed a complete loss last year in the relocation business, and that was okay, because this year that same team has turned around the business so much, and we're going to have the best year we've ever had in 26 years.
Very lovely. The one last question for the evening is addressed to Dr. Ranjini Mani.
Yes.
Yes, give it. Yeah. Go ahead.
My question is addressed to Rohini Manin. I have two questions for you. How we have star kids in film industry, and since because you're born in a business family, everything you hear and talk is all about business, that made you to enter into business, or is it really your passion to be into business? That's my first question. And my second question is, just now a few minutes back you answered to someone's question and you said you should balance personal life and professional life. Because you are born in a business family, lot of doors are easily openable to you. Will it be the same for a common woman who is going to be a first generation entrepreneur? What type of hurdles she need to face? Your life is different and a common woman's life is different. For you, everything is easy. For them, it's very difficult. So how would you like to comment on them?
Very, very good questions. I'll take the first question first.
What I'm trying to say is, if father is an actor, that there are greater chances for the child to be in film industry. Is it the case in you?
Definitely. I think children are influenced by their parents. You hear this very often. My mother keeps saying it. Don't worry that your children don't listen to you. Worry that they watch you. And I've had fantastic role models. My father's run such a successful business and sold it to a large French conglomerate. And like I said, he's my role model. I can't see anything else I'd want to do other than business. And it is my passion. Real estate is my passion, not any business. I know that it is my passion, so I'm very happy doing it. Even if I could have all the money in the world and say, follow your passion, I would not do anything else. I would do what I'm doing today. And I definitely have a platform. I'm very privileged. I'm very privileged to be my parents' daughter. I'm very privileged to be here today and have a platform to start off on. But I would disagree with you that it's easy for a woman entrepreneur. In our country, whoever the woman entrepreneur is, and Kalpana will agree, especially in real estate, it's still very hard. People treat you differently because you're a woman. They automatically look at to the man in the room thinking he's the decision maker. So you have to stand up for yourself and you have to speak with conviction and confidence to get your way. But that being said, I definitely have it easier than first generation women entrepreneurs. And challenges they'll face is, it is hard to make door openings. It is hard to get debt or loans or capital or equity, but don't give up. Keep trying, and other women entrepreneurs like me have your back. So reach out to me. Any of you who want to do anything in business, reach out to me on LinkedIn, Instagram, Facebook, and I'm here to help you.
Lovely. Great, madam. We'll take this offer. We've got a mentor-mentee page and we are going to add your name there.
Happy to do this.
Yes. Thank you so
much.
To
the boys as well, not just girls.
Yes. And one final question to Dr. Ranjini Mani. It has come from Mr. Francis from Pondicherry. He says, madam, what are the suggested steps which companies should take to equal out the ground and improve the representation of women in a given industry? You also want to know, why are the companies more diverse and inclusive when the business case in favor of the culture and equality strengthen each year? And why is that share of women leadership position is still so low when so much of opportunity is still given to them?
That is the question that I had, and that's why I started a foundation. Why, when equal number of men and women are getting college education, only 24% of them are coming to work? That's what the labor force participation in the workforce report, the gender report showed. And I think the reason is two. One is, culturally, we automatically have been saying to our boys, go work, and we've been saying to our girls, go make a home. So I think the cultural upbringing is also got to be looked at. And the second is, when there is diversity and inclusion in the company, it has to be from the top down. I work with a company now called GE Healthcare, And Shravan Subramanian is the managing director of that company. He used to be a Madras boy who owned Ehrlich Laboratories. He left Ehrlich and ran off to become a huge business leader in pharmacy businesses, right? And he believes in diversity and inclusion right from day one. So when the top leadership believes in it, then there will be a very good chance that everybody else, all the other management levels of people will start hiring more women in their departments. And not only that, they'll give women a place at the table, they'll give women a chance to be equally in the team. The first part of the question that Francis asked is, why is it culturally?
Yes. Yes.
Why is it culturally not working for us? See, we have been putting women on a pedestal for too long. We can't be doing these Lakshmi. It was all right to tell Jeff Bezos Lakshmi and Saraswati are goddesses, but we don't want to be goddesses now. You've got to give us an equal spot in the workplace, because we bring certain things to you and to your team and to your business where your profit will increase. We bring intuition. You'll think the business meeting went very well. The woman will notice a little facial look that the customer gave, which the man will miss. Our brains are engineered differently. So if equally having gender balance in a team is actually gender intelligent, and your profits will increase if you have more women at the workplace.
True, madam. We need more brave women. Not only Lakshmi and Saraswati, we need Durga also, I suppose. Sir, your closing remarks before.
So, you know, after some of these sessions, people say, good session, etc. I say, if you unveil a diamond on the stage, then the credit goes to who? The credit goes to the diamond, for being a diamond. So thank you for being my diamonds today. It was truly an outstanding session. In terms of content, in terms of meatiness, of what you said, I think it was by far the best session that I ever had the privilege of hosting. Thank you very much. And to the audience, I have a request. There is a QR code seeking feedback as usual. Please give us your feedback. But more importantly, we have come to realize that there are unique businesses, there are unique entrepreneurs out there whom we may not know of, whom we may not have access to. So if you know of such who you think are worthy of being highlighted, please do write to us, and we are happy to take them and bring them on stage. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Shankar. All the viewers watching, the QR code is on the display. Please do, your feedback is very important. Thank you, Dr. Anjamanin, Dr. Rogni, and really a pleasure to have you with us this evening. And on behalf of all the members of MME, as usual, we give them a lot of masks. Today, we are also going to give you some books in addition to the mask, because we have to change our giving masks and injections and jab. In the meanwhile, may I request Mali to join us on stage to present a memento to all the distributors.
And can I just say, it's wonderful that